Happy to have Slaid Cleaves and Michael O'Connor in the studios down here. In Studio A is what we call this one here. Let's see if these microphones are working.
Happy day after Thanksgiving, Dave.
Yeah. Slade's coming in town because he's doing his yearly day after Thanksgiving gig over at Sam's Burger Joint. How long you been doing that?
I'm not sure. It started as the Thanksgiving Eve up in Austin at the Saxon Pub. That was, I think, 18 years ago was the first one. And we skipped a couple because we were out of town or something. But I think we've done 15 at the Saxon. I think we've done at least 10 here in San Antonio.
I think so, yeah. It's sort of a standard.
Yeah, it works well.
It's already on the books for next year?
Exactly. It's simple. And some people, bless their hearts, have made it part of their family Thanksgiving tradition to come to the Slaid Show. And either here in Houston or we started in Galveston. We started the first annual at the Old Quarter last year.
Ah, okay. Okay. Yeah. And you're coming in town, just getting off of a multi-week tour up north, or
yeah.
Is that the case?
My wife Karen and I, you know, we grew up in Maine, so we have family and friends up there. So 30 years ago when we moved to Texas, we sort of started sort of an annual migratory pattern, just like the birds and the fruit pickers, you know. It gets too hot in Texas, we load up the minivan and play shows all the way up to Maine for 2 or 3 weeks, and then hang out in Maine for September, October. Starts getting cold, start heading south. So 5 weeks ago, we left Portland, Maine to did 5 weeks of shows all the way down across to the Midwest and back to the East Coast, down to Florida and across the Gulf Coast. And we just got to Texas just a week ago.
Now, when you do those shows, are they venues, or are they some of them house concerts?
We do the occasional house concert, but it's mostly venues.
Yeah.
You know, mostly listening rooms, you know, small venues.
Right,
clubs.
Right. Are there still plenty of those available?
There are. It's amazing how many there are. Sometimes, you know, it might be a 6 or 7 hour drive between them, and that can be tough. But usually we keep it down to 2 or 3 hours between shows.
Yeah. Because, yeah, that's San and I know New Braunfels has at least a couple, I believe. And
sure.
Then there's some house concerts. And there's more of those than there used to be. Pre COVID, there used to be a lot more house concerts down here than I even was aware of. Then you'd be like, "Oh, you never heard of that one?" You know, right. You heard that one. Almost every neighborhood, hip neighborhood, had a house concert.
And, yeah, there's a lot around here.
Yeah, yeah, and you get exposed to folks that aren't going to go out to a gig. Aren't going to go out to a club.
It's good to do different venues. You know, you don't want to get stuck in a rut. And a house concert is very different from playing a bar or a music club. We added a new venue last year. We played the Cave with No Name in Burney.
I was going to ask you about that.
Yeah.
Because that's, you're coming up on it.
It's coming up in a couple of weeks, yeah. I think it's sold out already because it's, you know, it's a very limited capacity, I think.
What is that like for you?
It's really cool. You go down about 5 flights of stairs, so it's not for the weak-hearted. 5 flights of stairs into a, you know, damp.
There's no loading ramp, right?
No elevator. but there's a nice stage and a beautiful sort of cathedral of a cavern. You know, it's about the size of a church. And so you put 200 chairs in there, and you don't use a PA system. We don't, anyway. And you just hear the natural reverb echoing around the stalactites and stalagmites, I guess. And it's a really beautiful gig, yeah.
So I guess with the acoustics like that, the audience also needs to sort of keep quiet.
They do. That's important. And I'm very, very lucky to have an audience across the country that's pretty well trained wherever I go. You know, they come to listen to the words, so
right.
I don't have to struggle with that. Like in the old days when Michael and I would be playing barroom gigs with the TV going and the hockey game on and people playing pool and stuff like that.
Yeah, when you get into those songs that everybody sings along to, the Horseshoe Lounge and all that stuff.
I'm
glad you brought up the Cave Without a Name. I haven't attended one of those, but every musician I've talked to has said it's pretty unique, needless to say.
I heard about it from Terry Hendrix's website. Well, I saw her. I think she was
exactly.
The
I think Terry and Lloyd mentioned that one time. Yeah, that they do them exactly. Mm-hmm. Talking to Slaid Cleaves and Michael O'Connor is not talking so much. He's doing his Winter Texan gig right now. Living in Washington, correct?
That's correct. Summers in Washington and winters in Texas.
And you, music. You keep music going.
I've been busy since I got to Texas nonstop, yeah.
Yeah? Backing up folks and playing solo gigs? And
exactly, yeah.
Whatever.
Yeah, whoever calls, call me, y'all.
There you go. He's out there. Anyway, they're playing tonight over at Sam's Burger Joint. You both got guitars with you. How about gracing us with a tune?
Love to. You mentioned the Horseshoe Lounge. This is my sequel to the Horseshoe Lounge.
My drinking days are over, no more nights at the carousel. My buddies say they're gonna miss me, but who could ever tell? I never knew what time it was till closing time came round. My drinking days are over, but I'm still trouble bound. I used to hang at the Horseshoe. You'd see me spinning at the Broken Spoke. I'd take some gal down to Green Hall. We lived on whiskey and smoke. Don't know how it all started. Didn't mean to hurt no one. Some bad luck, what's done can't be undone. Well, it was way past midnight, Anita hollered out, last call. I turned around and Wrangling Ron was headed for a brawl. I didn't know that other guy was a cop, I guess I didn't care. And sometimes you gotta act like you got a pair. That's what Wrangling Ron told me one time. My drinking days are over, no more nights at the carousel. No more fights, no more neon lights. I guess it's just as well. I never knew what time it was till closing time came round. My drinking days are over, but I'm still trouble bound. I got a ride out to Huntsville, but I'll be there for a while. Staring out a mesh window, mile after mile. I don't have any regrets, well, maybe just a few. But a man's gonna do what he's gonna do. My drinking days are over, no more nights at the carousel. My buddies say they're gonna miss me, they can go to hell. I never knew what time it was till closing time came round. My drinking days are over, but I'm still trouble bound. I never knew what time it was till closing time came round. My drinking days are over, but I'm still trouble bound. My drinking days are over.
out, crowd goes wild. Drinking Days, how old is that tune?
Well, let's see. I probably wrote that around 20 years ago.
Ah.
That's hard to believe.
So you've got, is this new one then your 15th, 14th? What do we go? What did I write here?
About
I looked at
12,
notes.
I think, maybe. It depends how you count them. You know, there's some EPs, some live albums, some
Was there
cassettes.
Any that you just put out on a cassette? There.
Yeah, there was, my very first one came out on a cassette in 1990 when I still lived in Maine.
Ah.
It's called The Promise.
Ah. And it never went past cassette?
You know what? It was reissued maybe in 2000. We reissued it on CD along with a another cassette that I recorded around that time with my band in Maine called the Moxie Men.
Mm-hmm.
So it's a little double CD.
I was looking at your bio, and it said something about, it talked about those bands, and then it said something that you were doing something with a Hammond organ. Did you play keyboards first?
I did. I took piano lessons as a kid, and my buddy Rod Picott started a garage band in 1980 called the Magic Rats, and he recruited me as the piano player to play those Tom Petty songs and Springsteen and Bob Seger songs. And then in my next band, I got a Hammond organ from my next band, which is a cover band playing new wave songs in the bars and the Asian restaurants
like
and stuff like
a
that.
A B3?
I did get not a full B3, I got a Porta B,
uh-huh.
Which breaks down into a top and a bottom. You know, bottom with the pedals, and there's a stand, and then the top. It's not quite as big as B3. It's big enough. It's heavy enough.
But did it have the Leslie?
I had a full one Leslie 122. Wow. Yeah, it sounded beautiful, man. Yeah, I love that thing. But the band I was in at the time, we practiced and stored our stuff in a basement. So after every run of gigs, we'd have to haul that thing down the basement stairs. Oh, man, it was rough.
Damn, yeah, that's a tough one.
That's before they had the electronic ones that sounded pretty good.
They do sound pretty good.
They do now.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I think. Talking to Slaid Cleaves and Michael O'Connor playing tonight over at Sam's Burger Joint. What else was I going to ask you about? So, yeah, 5 weeks on the tour. Since I am a craft beer person, Bike Rack Brewery.
Yeah.
Did they make a beer after you? I looked at your Facebook.
Yeah, it's
what's the deal with that?
Never understood that. It's up in where is it? Up in Little Rock? No, it's in
Arkansas.
Arkansas.
It said Bentonville Bike Rack Brewery. It was some post on. It was I believe it was
they
on
just put
your
my
post
name,
or your wife's post.
They stenciled my name onto one of their beer tanks, like fermentation tanks.
Oh,
so I don't know why. And somebody's a fan, I guess.
Slaid. How many Slaids do you have? You is Slaid a common? You know, when I Google Slaid, what first came up, it said, "Well, of course you."
Yeah.
And then it said, "Slaid is a 6-point word in Scrabble." It mentioned that.
No kidding.
Yeah, and it's a usable word in that Wordle game, daily game thing. It's a legal game. It's legal word.
Huh.
In that too, but it did say, and then basically it was all about you.
Well, I've got a cousin named Slaid Leatherman, is my cousin's kid actually, so a second cousin, I guess. It's an old family name. It was my great grandmother's maiden name, and so it became a middle name amongst cousins. And
it's your middle name.
It's my middle name,
right?
Richard Slaid Cleaves. I'm named after my grandfather. Yeah.
Oh.
Yeah.
Yeah, I just...
There's a few of us out there, not many.
Pretty much when you say, oh, I'm going to go see Slaid, they're like, you're it, dude.
Yeah, somebody...
it's like Cher, Elton,
that's right.
Slaid.
Slaid.
Slaid.com is my
Slaid.
Website.
Unless you get into the metal the genre, then and there's probably numerous Slaids somewhere or another.
That's right.
But I just wondered about that. But yeah, it said it's a 6-point word in Scrabble.
Now that must be S-L-A-D-E, right?
No one said S-L-A-I-D.
Really?
Huh. Yeah, so.
Huh.
But on the internet, is that true? Who knows?
I think it means little hill or something like that.
Something like
English.
Yeah.
Old English.
Exactly. Talking to Slaid, we're getting into name recognition here on the Third Coast Music Network with Michael O'Connor. So you guys, Michael, you're going to be doing this next sort of Texas tour?
Yeah, I'm the guitar player for the Texas tour. Yep. That'll be me.
And What have you been up to lately? I mean, I know you're living up there, and you said you had put out a release right around when everything shut down.
I came down and played the Dripping Springs Songwriter Festival, and then I played, you know, it all gets blurry, but I've played in some blues bands since I've been here. I've done some solo gigs. I'm playing some with a guy named Pat Byrne, who's a great singer from Ireland that's living in Austin.
Yeah, I've heard the name. Yeah.
And Carrie Sweeney, Susan Gibson, all the normal suspects I normally play with, I've been working with.
Yeah. It's good to see those guys.
Yeah, it's been wonderful to see everyone, man. Yeah. Everyone at the shows, everyone's faces. It's been a great thing. It really makes me grateful to be here playing for everyone.
Yeah, it's interesting when I haven't gotten to see Carrie in a while, but I always seem to see his name on a music schedule after the fact. I'm like, damn.
Y'all are one of the first people to play him, I think, actually.
We've still got the stuff down here, exactly. Right. We get requests for that. And I guess that's what we get for our show's been on since 1991. So we got a lot of music from record labels that don't exist anymore, musicians, unfortunately, that aren't around anymore, all that kind of stuff. So it's to me, it's... Yeah, we've got an archive library that a lot of people have no, you know, they don't even know exists. Part of, you know, living close to Austin, always there's a good batch of musicians up there.
Mm-hmm.
Right. Talking to Slaid Cleaves and Michael O'Connor.
1991, it just occurred to me, the day after Thanksgiving, 1991 was the day that Karen and I packed up a 74 Dodge Dart Sport in Maine and headed out for Texas. So it was, do the math here, 31 years ago today.
Yeah.
I left Maine to move to Texas.
Now, you had been down here visiting? Had you checked it out?
Only once, like 6 months prior. Karen got a week off of work and we drove 3 days to Austin to check it out, stayed for 2 or 3 days. There was only one family we knew in Austin. We didn't have any connections beside this one friend of the family. We turned around and drove back, stopped at Graceland on the way, went back to Maine, and just started saving our money for the big move. We were 26, 27 years old, something like that, just kids.
So were you doing music up there then?
Yeah, I'd been playing in Portland, Maine for about 3 years, playing local bar gigs and working my way into the sort of opening act for people like Loudon Wainwright and Jonathan Richman and people like that.
Oh.
So just working my way into the scene, but I felt like I really needed to be in more of a music-centered scene. You know, Portland, Maine has a great little scene, but it's not enough to build a career out of. So
yeah.
I needed to go to Austin and open up for Joe Ely and people like that and just study.
When you got down here, was it tough to get intertwined with the group?
It was really tough. It was starting from scratch.
Now, there's Cactus Cafe, I guess, was there. What was the other one?
That was the one lead we had. We had Griff's phone number at the Cactus Cafe, but he didn't give me a gig for a couple of years. I just started busking. I went to Square One. I started busking on 6th Street, doing open mics month after month, and about 4 or 5 months after we moved here, was a New Folk winner out of Kerrville. That was a nice little validation that I was on the right path. But at that moment, we had used my very first credit card, the cash advance, to pay our last month of rent because we were so broke. I was doing medical research studies for money.
Ooh,
yeah. And so we hightailed it back to Maine right after Kerrville, where I had a bunch of gigs that I had built up over the years. And so we got our coffers replenished up in Maine and then headed back down in October again.
So is that how you got the record deal with Philo/Rounder, I guess? Was through the recognition of the Kerrville deal?
Kind of. I think, Roger Allen, he does some DJ work. Roger and Cash, they're from
I've heard
Austin.
The name. Yeah.
Roger used to host that Sitting and Singing on Wednesdays, Sitting and Singing and Supper, something like that, at Threadgill's North, with Butch Hancock and Jimmy Dale and Champ Hood and those guys. I used to do the open mic set up there, and so when Ken Irwin from Rounder Records came to Austin in 1994, probably. He asked Cash and Roger, he said, who's new in town? Who should I go check out? And they said, well, there's this young kid named Slaid from Maine, and he's pretty good. He's got something going. So Ken came and saw me. I remember it was on a loading dock, some little outlaw showcase for South by Southwest, way off the beaten path. And he just struck up a conversation, and over the next couple of years, he came and saw me play a few times. And at one point, he said, hey, I think we might want to help you out, which was, you know, changed my life. You know, I was able to make a record with Gurf Morlicks, the great producer and guitar player, and got a record put out nationally for the first time in 1996. And over the next few years, just sort of built things up.
And then broke down.
Can't
hurt. That didn't hurt.
Yep, couldn't hurt at all. Yeah, that really changed my life. Yeah.
Speaking of producers, Scrappy Judd is, you're back with Scrappy Judd on producing the upcoming release.
Yep, Scrappy's done the last three records, and he tours with us as well. So we just, he did the first leg of the fall tour, and our friend Jojo Jacques did the second leg, and Michael's doing the Texas leg. So we like to rotate our side guys out just to keep the crowds interested, you know, something different every time. And plus, we're traveling in a little minivan, so 5 weeks in a minivan with me and my wife and a side guy, you know, we're all good friends still, but we don't want to push our luck.
Yeah, exactly. So since you're using Scrappy, you said this is the third time that he produced?
That's right.
What do you look for, like, in a producer? Is it just somebody you can get along with? Is it somebody that's got an ear that, with the end product, just comes out the way you want, or what?
It's really scary. I mean, because you're entering into an intimate agreement that's going to cost a lot of money, and you don't want to waste it. And it's going to cost a lot of. It's going to require a lot of soul searching and communing with each other. You know, you got to have someone you can communicate with. So, starting with a new producer is always super scary. When it was when I had my first round of record with Gurf, I had heard the records he made with Lucinda Williams and other people, and I just thought, that's the kind of thing I'm going for. You know, it's got influences of country and folk and rock and roll and a mixture of acoustic and electric and you know, really well written parts, instrumental parts. And so it was just a dream to work with Gurf, and made four records with him, and you know, felt the need to branch out a little bit and try something new. And I'd seen Scrappy around town for so many years and heard a few of his records that he made with Chris Montgomery, and I think that's the one I really liked the most. So hired him to be side guy for a while and listened to what he came up with for my song, my new batch of songs, and thought to myself, well, Scrappy should be the next producer. So that started a relationship that we've had for the last 10 years or so.
Yeah, you can hang out in the van together.
Oh, yeah.
And Karen. Karen puts up with both y'all.
It's like, she says, it's like having two husbands.
So you're you're one of the husbands, Michael?
Oh, I've been in the menage a trois for a long
you
time,
were
man.
Long time backer with...
He was on the Broke Down World Tour. Actually, a little something happened on the way to his first gig on the Broke Down World Tour. What happened? I can't remember, Michael.
I broke down.
That's right.
I'd only met Slaid a few times. It's like when my car broke down trying to get to meet them in the van. I just thought, man, I'm so glad his record, his name broke down, because I was feeling like a heel. But they came and saved me, and we started out. Yeah.
Yeah. Well, speaking of the, you've got one single out released, I guess, to radio on the upcoming, it's called Through the Dark?
The album's called Together.
Together Through the Dark, and this tune is called Through the Dark.
That's right.
Any set up to it? Can we play it?
That would be wonderful, yeah.
Any set up to it? I guess this is the title track then.
Yeah, well, sort of. The title is slightly different. I don't know why I did that. It's confusing, isn't it?
Well, see, that's what I was wondering. I was like, well, did they just forget to put the together on the song title?
I remember thinking about it and thinking there's a reason to do this, but now I can't remember the reason. But Together Through the Dark was written, like Broke Down, it's one of these co-writes with my old buddy Rod Picott, who, you know, we were in our first band together in 1980, the Magic Rats, and we've been friends ever since, even before that, since grade school, but writing songs for 30 years. I think we've written over two dozen songs. But Through the Dark is one that he brought to me, and we banged out on email back and forth over a few months during the pandemic. And it's the first single.
All right. And it's available now on all those places that play good music.
It's supposed to be, yeah.
Supposed to be. Here it is, Through the Dark, brand new music from Slaid Cleaves. Upcoming release that is going to be coming out, when might that be?
I think it's March 2nd, something like that.
Well, if you think it's March 2nd, then, I mean, it's an independent release. You're not on a label.
That's
is that
true.
Correct?
It's not set in stone. I can release it whenever I want.
Ah, there you go. There you go. Have something to sell. Yeah. Have to show off that new baby. Then you'll be touring quite a bit more.
Yeah, more than average. Although, you know, we're settled into this sort of seasonal touring pattern, and so it won't change a whole lot from that.
Yeah, because I think for this year you did you came into San Antonio, didn't you play?
We usually just do the post Thanksgiving show at Sam's. Yeah,
yeah, yeah,
and stuff in the Hill Country. Then after that,
yeah. You're tuned in to San Antonio College Radio, KSYM. I'm Dave. We're listening to we're talking to Slaid Cleaves and Michael O'Connor. Slaid and Michael are going to be playing tonight over at Sam's Burger Joint. You can get more information on that at samsburgerjoint.com. Okay, now's the contest part of the Gee interview.
Uh-oh.
My neighbor goes to thrift stores. She said, oh, you're a DJ and you like country music, so I got you the country music
awesome.
Trivialogies.
Oh,
it was still shrink-wrapped. And it's the 2005 edition. When
is that floater on the cover there?
When country was, is that floater?
It looks like Gary Floater on the cover.
You know. And so it's the two when country was very hot, the 2005 year. Hmm. So I said, what am I going to do with this thing? So we've got the cards. You're up comp. So far, I've only done it with Mary Gaucher and Jamie Harris. Hmm. They got 3 out of 3.
Wow. Impressive.
So, of course, they're living in Music City,
yeah.
USA. So, well, you're sort of. So, what we're going to do, cut the cards. We're going to ask you 3 questions. And then I'll have you sign the card later.
Okay.
Cut the cards. I don't want you to think I. Okay, this is what we're going to do. It's we've got 3 categories here: big star, country chart topper, and free ride to Music City. What do we want first, folks? You can work together.
Yeah, I'm gonna have to work together.
I don't know any new stuff.
Who knows? Like I say, Mary Gaucher. And okay, what do we want? Big star, country chart topper.
Better do big star because that's the only ones.
Okay. Helen Cornelius and her duet partner, formerly of the Browns, had the 1976 #1 country single, I Don't Want to Have to Marry You. Boy, I wouldn't know that. It is a male.
No idea.
Formerly of the Browns.
Don't remember the Browns.
I don't know. Can I just take a guess?
Yeah.
T.G. Shepherd.
Nope, Jim Ed Brown.
Oh, Jim Ed
Brown. I wouldn't have known that either. Yeah, okay. Country chart topper or free ride to Music City?
Free ride.
All right. Playing It Straight, Garth Brooks. Good luck on that. Okay. Hit it big with the song Two of a Kind, Working on a Full House. From what 1990 album? I wouldn't have.
Never bought a Brooks Garth album. Brooks Garth.
No Fences.
I heard of that. That's a big one.
Okay. Yeah. I think this one.
0-2. Yeah.
Country chart topper. One of country music's all-time greatest hits. The 1949 song Lovesick Blues was recorded by who?
Well, that one's too easy.
Well.
I can talk about that song with you for 15 minutes. That was the Hank Williams
song.
There
you go.
Which he debuted at the Grand Ole Opry, and they made him sing it, I think, 6 more times. They made him sing it over and over because people loved it so much.
At the same night?
Same night, same song. They made him sing it over and over again. The place just went nuts.
So they weren't sick of it,
It was a Tin Pan Alley song written in the 1920s, I think. for like a blackface performer with that yodel. Emmett, what was his name? Emmett something. Yeah, that's a.
You started the conversation, Slaid.
You've redeemed yourself with extra trivia knowledge. Right.
Yeah, there you go. Okay, well, that's it. One out of three. Mary Gaucher, Jamie Harris, three out of three. Not saying that theirs were easier or harder, but the Garth Brooks thing, I would not have a clue on any of that kind of stuff. Talking to Slaid Cleaves and Michael O'Connor, why don't we do one more song live and then let you guys get to dinner or load in or whatever.
All of the above.
All of the above.
Yeah. Let's do the Texas Love song. For you, I give up all my time, searching for the perfect rhyme. And this is one that certainly perplexes. For you, I would spend all my days thinking up all the crazy ways I love you. Even more than I love Texas. You got Bel Air class, Dallas style, Austin soul, and a Luckenbach smile. For you I'd trade my truck in for a Lexus. You smell as sweet as the piney woods. I'd marry you if I thought I could. I love you even more than I love Texas. You're the barb on my wire, sparking my campfire. There's no brighter star in all the multiplexes. I love this state, you know I do, but the best thing in this state is you. I love you even more than I love Texas. Wits as sharp as a prickly pear. The sun shines in your golden hair. Your smile hits me right in the solar plexus. Skin is soft as early morning rain. Temper like a Gulf Coast hurricane. I love you even more than I love Texas. From the mucky duck to the broken spoke, you'd know this state like an old cowpoke. You know where all the tastiest Tex-Mex is. You got Dave on the radio playing Robert Earl and Billy Joe. I love you even more than I love Texas. You're the barb on my wire, the spark in my campfire. Let's head out west where nobody can text us. I promise you I'll never cheat. And if you throw me out in the old mesquite, I love you even more than I love Texas. And if you make me leave the state, well, I'll groan, but I won't hesitate. 'Cause I love you even more than I love Texas.
Yodeling for your musical pleasure this afternoon, Slaid Cleaves and Michael O'Connor. If you like what you hear, and even if you're not sure, you can go over to Sam's Burger Joint and find out and tell them what you think. Showtime is, I know, I should be asking the wife, correct?
Probably 8, I think.
Probably 8 o'clock. We can find out there. More information, samsburgerjoint.com. So what's so you got the gig, you got the CD coming out, you've got numerous gigs through, I looked at, I mean, you're Port Aransas, you're...
It's next couple of weeks, pretty busy, and then we'll just hunker down for the winter, a month or two, just get prepared for the record release.
And you're going to hang down in Texas for how long?
Till the end of March. I have a bunch of gigs booked, so I'll be around.
And then the weather gets, you said it was 4 degrees?
It was 4, the night.
And that is?
Where I'm from.
You're sort of, you said 30 miles or so from?
Canada.
Canada. That's up there.
A long way for a Corpus Christi boy, huh?
Gee, yeah.
As far as you can possibly get.
That's exactly the idea.
Yeah. All right. One of the, I looked on my database and I put in your name, and we have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 I guess sort of tribute CDs that you've been included in. Do you enjoy doing those?
Yeah, those are great. Yeah.
Do you? Is it? Do they give you a? They give you a variety of songs to choose from, or how does that usually?
Normally, they have one in mind.
Depending on the producer, I guess.
Yeah, normally the people have one in mind. It's real easy because I only have to learn one song, and I'm not making decisions or self-producing or anything. So I just learn the song, and I get to be on a song with a bunch of like-minded, usually friends. You know, I did a.
Because we've got the Woody Guthrie one. We've got the Adam Carroll.
Great.
We've got this one. Songs of Route 66.
Oh yeah,
that one. Like I say, we've got stuff here that probably is not even around anymore. A Fred Eagle Smith tribute.
That's a hard one to find. You can't get that one.
Which one?
The stream. I can't find that on.
Is it worth money?
Services. I don't know, but you can't get it on streaming. I know that.
Ah, and then of course the Hubbard.
Oh yeah.
Disc.
Nice.
Well, then we ought to play the Fred Eagle Smith one.
Yeah, it's a cool song called what's it called? White Rose.
Let me see. Oh yeah.
Closed down filling station.
See, where is that? Bah, 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 bah. Oh, it's number one, the number one track.
What an honor.
Anyway, talk amongst yourselves.
This was I did this with, I think I did this with Plankenhorn and Billy Bright and Bryn Bright, I believe. We did this live around a microphone just like the Bluegrass guys.
And, of course, here's the CD that's not loading up correctly. Come on.
We did this up in Nashville, I believe, while we were on tour. I can't remember what studio it was, but...
It's during Folk Alliance, wasn't it?
That sounds right. Yeah.
So the song is called... The project was called The Songs of Fred Eagle Smith, a tribute. And a lot of usual suspects on here, names you would remember and know. And the number one track on here, Slaid Cleaves doing White Rose. Once again, thanks, guys, for coming in and stopping by a little bit before you head over to Sam's Burger Joint. It's always great to do this Thanksgiving gig.
Thanks for having us over.
It's almost like a sort of like a family reunion.
Yeah,
you get to see people that you don't get to see a lot.
That's true.
And then you so what new merch do you have to sell? Candles?
I'm so glad you asked.
Did I see candles? Did I see candles?
Where did you hear about that?
I was on a Facebook page post.
Yeah, there's a new song, a song on the new album called The Terlingua Chili Queen. And it was Cameron's idea to come up with a scented candle that commemorates the songs. We have these candles that a chef friend of ours made, and they come in recycled soup cans, basically. And he came up with 3 scents, custom made. He's got chili pepper, cilantro lime, and beef chili scent. And
they smell so when you.
Even before you light them, they're smelling up the car right now. It smells great. Makes us hungry driving down the road.
Only available at the gigs.
At the gigs. They're too heavy to mail, so they're at the gigs only this time.
There you go. Pick up your pick one up as a gift. You know, you could go not the malls, but you could go out somewhere and do all your Black Friday shopping, or you could get entertainment this evening and do your shopping at the Slaid Cleaves Boutique right at Sam's Burger Joint. All right, guys, thank you very much. Here's the song from the Fred Eaglesmith tribute. Here's Slaid Cleaves.